Transfer of property of goods. We know that goods are bifurcated into three types. And what are those types? First is existing, second is future, third is contingent. So here we can see that there are specific, ascertained and unascertained goods. So all of them, I mean these three, belong to the existing category. So if you, you know, want to understand specific goods are existing goods, ascertained goods are existing goods, unascertained goods are also existing goods. And then you have a separate category, future goods. Then you have a separate category, contingent goods. However, future, you know, the law for the provisions for future and contingent goods is same. So whatever applies to future goods also applies to contingent goods. So now going one step below, basically we have four things. First is provisions relating to specific goods, provisions relating to ascertained goods, provisions relating to unascertained goods, and finally provisions relating to future goods. Now specific goods are those goods. Let me first tell you what is existing goods. We've already done this, it's just a recap. Existing goods are those goods which exist, which are into being when the contract of sale is being made, which are present at the time of the contract of sale. When the buyer and seller are making the contract, those goods are present. Those goods are in existence. It's not like that they will be produced. They have already been produced. It's not like they will grow and then you'll cut the harvest. No, they have already grown and the harvest has been cut. So they are in existence for sale now. You can sell them because they are in existence. Those are existing goods. Future goods are those goods which will come into existence on a future date. They are not in existence at the time of the contract of sale. So that sale contract becomes an agreement to sell. Whenever you sell future goods, it is always an agreement to sell. Because the goods are not in existence, how can you make the sale contract? Because for a sale contract, the transfer of ownership is required. Ownership can only be of those goods which are in existence. Goods which do not exist, how can you transfer the ownership? They do not have ownership because they themselves are not in existence. So there can be no sale contract. So the agreement that you make becomes an agreement to sell. Now what are specific goods? Specific goods are those goods which are agreed by both buyer and seller. They are separately identified at the time of the contract of sale. So when the buyer and the seller are making the contract of sale, they are agreed and separately identified. These are goods which are separately identified at the time of sale. Let's say you go to purchase a kg of rice from a shop, from a grocer. So he removes, he separates that 1 kg of rice for you. That means that rice which has been separated now, that 1 kg rice becomes specific. Let's say he does not separate it at the time of sale. He tells you, you know, okay, I'll deliver the rice to your place. I'll separate them and then deliver the rice to your place after an hour. So at the time of sale, the goods weren't separately identified. And later on, the seller will apportion them. He'll identify them separately. Such goods are called as ascertained goods. Goods apportioned or separately identified after sale. They are separately identified at the time, and they are separate. Ascertained goods are separately identified after the contract of sale. There is only the difference of time. Specific goods at the time of sale, ascertained goods after the sale contract. And unascertained goods are not separately identified. They are a part of the whole stock of goods. Okay. So these are specific, ascertained and unascertained goods. If the seller does not separately identify the goods and the goods are kept with the bulk in his godown, that means those goods are unascertained. They have not been separately identified for you. Okay. Now let's see what are the provisions relating to specific goods. When does the property transfer in specific goods? When does the property transfer in ascertained goods? When does the property transfer in unascertained goods? And what are the provisions relating to future goods? So in case of specific goods, they'll either be in deliverable state or they'll not be in deliverable state. Now let us understand what is deliverable state. Deliverable state means it is the state of goods such that the buyer cannot refuse the delivery/acceptance of goods. Deliverable state is that state of goods. Goods are in that state wherein the buyer cannot refuse the acceptance of delivery. He cannot say, no, I cannot accept the goods. They are not complete. They are not finished. Some work needs to be done. No. The goods have been completed. Whatever was to be done, cutting, polishing, testing, packaging, giving finishing touches, whatever was required to make them a finished product, everything has been done. Whatever it may be, whatever process may be, all the processes relating to the goods are complete, and they are in that state now wherein if you deliver the goods to the buyer, he cannot refuse the delivery of the goods. He cannot refuse to accept the goods. He'll be bound to take the goods. He'll be bound to accept the goods. And when can we say that the goods are not in deliverable state? That means, something is required to be done on the goods. Something like, testing of goods, like polishing of goods, some cutting or some finishing work is required, some process is pending. So something in regards to the goods is pending. Some work relating to goods is pending. Now, what work is this? This may be some cutting, polishing, testing, packaging, etc. Any of these things may be pending. Since you've not packed the goods, you cannot deliver the goods. Thus, I cannot say that the goods are in the deliverable state. As easy as that. Since the goods have not yet been polished, let's say you've purchased the furniture. Now, if the furniture is not polished, can the seller deliver the goods? No, because they are not in the deliverable state as yet. So, some work relating to goods is pending. Then we say that the goods are not in deliverable state. Okay, so now let's see what are the rules relating to goods when they are in deliverable state and when they are in non-deliverable state. So, when the goods are in deliverable state, the property transfers at the time of contract. That means when the contract is made, the ownership gets transferred there and then on the spot at that time only. If the goods are specific and they are in deliverable state, the ownership transfers there and then immediately on the spot. Immediately. Okay. Now, once the goods are ready, they are in the deliverable state, but you know, let's say some work relating to the ascertainment of pricing of the goods is pending. You do not know the pricing of the goods. You know, let's say you've not measured the goods, you know, something which means measuring, weighing, etc. Some work like measuring of the goods, weighing of the goods, you know, is pending to ascertain the price. I know that the price of the bricks is 10 rupees per brick, but I have not counted how many bricks, you know, are there. So counting is pending. So once I count, I know that there are 1000 bricks, so 1000 into 10 will become 10,000. Then I know the price. So let's say counting is pending or measuring is pending. Let's say I am into sale of curtains. So I've sold, you have separately identified the curtains. They are in the deliverable state, but I need to measure them to ascertain the price. I've not measured as yet. Or I need to weigh the goods. The goods have been identified. You had, you know, selected the fruits or the vegetables you wanted. Now they need to be weighed to be sold to you. So they are in the deliverable state, but something is required to be done to ascertain the price. So when would the property in such goods get transferred? It will get transferred when the price is ascertained. Once the price is ascertained, the seller will give notice to the buyer. He'll tell him that I have ascertained the price of the goods. This is the price of the goods and I'll deliver the goods to you now. So as soon as the buyer gets the notice of the price of the goods, it will be assumed, it will be implied, it will be concluded that the property of the goods has been transferred. So if the goods are specific, there are two things, that they may be in deliverable state, they may not be in deliverable state. Now if they are in the deliverable state, there may again be two things, that the goods are ready, they are priced, they are measured, they are counted, they are weighed, then the property will transfer immediately at the time of making of the contract. But let's say the second case, that the goods have not been priced as yet. So the property in the goods will not get transferred at the time of making of the contract, but it will get transferred once the pricing of the goods is done, and then the notice to the buyer is given that the pricing has been done. Once the notice is given, the property in such goods will get transferred. Now, what is the rule regarding the goods which are not in deliverable state? If the goods are not in deliverable state, the seller has to put the goods in deliverable state. Whatever the work was pending relating to the, you know, finishing of the goods, packing of the goods, branding of the goods, whatever the work was pending, he has to do that work. Give the notice to the buyer that the goods are now in the deliverable state. The property gets transferred. Okay. So this was about specific goods. Now, same is the case for ascertained goods. You can see that this is a common case. Be it specific goods, be it ascertained goods. So, this rule applies for both ascertained as well as specific goods. Even in case of ascertained goods, that those goods may be in deliverable state or may not be in deliverable state. If they are in deliverable state, the property gets immediately transferred. If they are not in deliverable state, you know, do something to make them in deliverable state, the property will get transferred after giving the notice to the buyer. So, it's the same provision for both specific and ascertained. Now let's see, when does the property in goods get transferred for unascertained goods? For unascertained. Unascertained goods are those goods which are, you know, not separately identified by the seller for delivering them to the buyer. They are still in the bulk. They are still with the other goods. They are not separately identified. Okay. The rule is ascertain those goods. That is, separately identify the goods. Or make a unconditional appropriation. Now, what is the difference between ascertaining and unconditional appropriation? Ascertaining may be done by the buyer or the seller or by both. You know, the buyer may remove his goods that he wants from the bulk that the seller has, or the seller may remove. You would have seen that when you go to purchase grocery from your grocery store, you know, many times he gives you a basket and you select the goods that you want. You select the vegetables, and the other times what he does is he picks up, you know, the vegetables that he wants to sell you, puts them in the basket, weighs them and sells it to you. Or many times what happens is we both agree, we both separately identify. Let's say you go to purchase a cupboard or some furniture. So the buyer, seller shows you, you select, and then he tells you, you know, he tells you this is a good cupboard that you should purchase. This satisfies your want. And then you go and you okay it. So it is with the agreement of the both. So that is ascertainment. But appropriation is done by the seller. He himself selects the goods for you. So this is the difference between ascertainment and appropriation. However, it should be unconditional. The appropriation should be unconditional. Now, unconditional means there should not be conditions attached to appropriation. There should not be any, you know, qualifications or terms attached to this appropriation, as to, you know, it should not depend on any circumstances, on any contingencies, on any conditions. For example, if the seller, you know, appropriates the goods for the buyer, It means the ownership has transferred, and he should not say that the ownership will get transferred, you know, if it rains today, or if the buyer gives me, you know, advance payment, or if the buyer gives me payment by check. So he should not put any conditions. The appropriation should be unconditional. And since the appropriation is unconditional, as soon as he appropriates the goods, the ownership gets transferred, because there are no conditions to be followed. And this is the requirement, that the appropriation should be unconditional. And what is the rule relating to future goods? When does the property in the future goods get transferred? The property in the future goods get transferred when they are produced or manufactured. When they are produced or manufactured. So when they'll be manufactured or produced, at that point in time, the ownership will get transferred. Now, to make the idea clearer, you know, so that it's completely clear in your mind, let me give you some examples relating to ascertainment. Now, let's say this is the buyer and this is the seller. Now the seller has a godown here. This is the godown of the seller, and this is the complete stock that has been kept. This is the stock that has been kept. Let me mark it in blue. So this is the stock that he has kept. Okay. Now, this buyer goes to the seller and tells him, let's say he sells grains or cotton or whatever you want. Let's say cotton. So this seller is a dealer in cotton, and this is the total stock of cotton that he has. So this buyer goes to him and tells him that he wants cotton. So he asks him, how many bales or bags of cotton do you want? So the buyer says, I like to purchase 100 bags of cotton. And let's say there are 1,000 bags of cotton here. So now the seller tells him, okay, I'll deliver 100 bags of cotton to your shop or factory or, you know, wherever you want it to be delivered. Now what can you say? Are these goods existing, or these goods are future goods or contingent goods? These goods are existing. You can see they exist in the godown. So they are existing. So now, are they specific, ascertained, or an ascertained good? They are not specific goods. They would have been specific goods if they would have been separately identified at the time of the contract. But the contract has been made. The buyer has purchased 100 bags of cotton. Have the goods been separately identified? No, not yet. So till now, goods are unascertain. Now, after the buyer has gone, the seller, what he does is, removes this 100 bags of cotton and keeps it ready for delivery for the buyer. Okay, now you can see that these 100 bags have been separately identified. There is a separation of the goods from the bulk. Now this whole, the white portion belongs to the seller, and this shaded portion belongs to the buyer. They have been separately identified, and as soon as they are separately identified, the property in the goods, who becomes the owner now? The buyer becomes the owner. He becomes the owner now because the goods have been ascertained now. I told you the rule that as soon as the goods are ascertained, the property transfers. If they are complete, if they are in deliverable state. However, if they are not in deliverable state, they are required to be put into bags. Then after they are put into bags, the ownership will get transferred. But now let's say if they are in deliverable state, once the ascertainment is done, the ownership gets transferred. Okay. Now in this case, let us say after the ascertainment was done, there was a fire in the godown. There was a fire in the godown. Now who do you think would bear the loss of these 100 goods, 100 bags of cotton? The seller is responsible or the buyer is responsible? Who's responsible is the buyer. Why? Because the ownership has gotten transferred to the buyer. It has already transferred to the buyer from the seller. When the seller apportioned the goods, he separately identified the goods, the ownership went to the buyer. And the person who is the owner has to bear the risk, because the risk follows ownership. So the risk is with the buyer now. He'll have to bear the loss. It was his responsibility that he should have taken the goods from the seller's godown. However, if the seller said, "I will deliver the goods to you," in this case, the seller says, "I will deliver the goods to you. It is my responsibility to deliver the goods." Then seller will be responsible, because the seller is undertaking the responsibility to deliver. So until and unless the goods are delivered to the buyer, the seller will be responsible. However, if the seller did not say, the seller told the buyer that he'll separately apportion the goods, and once they are separately apportioned, you can take the goods from my godown. And he apportions this 100 bags and tells the buyer to remove them from his godown. But the buyer does not come, and there's a fire in the godown. Who will be responsible? The buyer will be responsible. So now you see, it is very important to understand as to who is the owner, who has the risk, so as to ascertain the liability, on whom the liability is. Okay. I'll give you one more example. You know, there's the same buyer and seller. The buyer comes to the seller and tells him, "I want 1,000 bags of cotton." And the seller has 1,000 bags of cotton in his godown, but he has not separately identified them. Now you may ask me, what is the need to separately identify those goods? And this is precisely the point. There is no need to separately identify these goods. These goods become specific goods, and the ownership gets transferred there and then, on the spot, immediately. And once the ownership gets transferred, whatever happens to the goods in the godown, let's say there's fire, now the buyer bears the risk. He bears the risk. However, if the seller told him, "I'll deliver the goods to you," And before delivery, there's fire in the godown. Seller is responsible. Now, let's say these goods were not separately identified. They were not separately identified. What will happen is, if there is fire, seller will bear the loss because the ownership in the goods had not transferred to the buyer. He was the owner. He had not separately apportioned the goods. So, it is very important to know who was the owner and who had the risk.